partnered by Times Influence.
AI, IoT and other technological advancements were brought into sharp focus at the fourth edition of the Economic Times Sales Strategy Summit 2018. The summit was graced by eminent sales leaders from the industry who deliberated on the evolution of sales strategies and how to tailor it to meet the needs of a dynamic consumer landscape. Brand guru Prahlad Kakkar shared his views on why it is important to connect with the young generation and think like them if you have to sell them your product.
So we are going to talk about social media. We're going to talk about the internet. Now, the problem with the internet and social media is, unfortunately for you all, it's young. And they talk a very different language. So they're not interested in having a one-way conversation with you as sellers. So when you try and sell to kids on the block or on social media and don't allow them to talk back to you and say, listen, Pop, or listen, Uncle, whichever is more derogatory, this is not what turns me on. This is not what does it for me. You're telling me all about yourself. I'm not interested. I'm interested in what your product is going to do for me. So when you think different and you admit that is what you are, then that is how you communicate. When you pretend that you're not that, and you're very respectable, and you wear a tie, and therefore you have your fly zippered all the time and it never comes down, then you do not address the internet and social media people. You cannot. You're talking a different language to start off with. Why would they want to watch your commercials? And even not block it off. So the reason why they wouldn't is because if they get a chance to actually talk to you, to open a dialogue, the fact is that the whole social media and the internet medium is meant for a dialogue. It's not meant for you guys to talk down to them. It's to engage. I mean, that's what it's really all about. That's what we should be working at. Not at trying to take advertising, which is meant for media, where you don't have any talkback system. Where you're talking to them and they don't get to talk to you. So you have a captive audience. Even a television is a captive audience. If you place your advertisement during a match, he's really pissed off that you're advertising there, not the playback. But he watches it. He doesn't turn it off. He doesn't switch channels. You're sitting in a movie hall, you're stuck. But when you're on the internet, you're on your own time. You're not stuck anywhere. You've got millions of options. Millions. So why would he stick to hearing some boring drudgery about how good your product is and what it's going to do to him if it's not interactive? So remember, you're on the internet, you're among young people. They have a different God. They don't believe in the same God as you do. So try and understand where they're coming from. And your first move is anybody who's above 40. Is to try and sit down on a dining table with your children and try and figure out where they're coming from, because they're your consumers. And if you're in conflict with your own children, you can never talk to the consumer, because that's them. So loosen up and you can sell. Become young. Start doing things which you always dreamt about but never had the guts to do it. It's not too late. Thank you.
The summit, themed on unlocking minds, also had a brief discussion between industry stalwarts who came together to share their ideas on how leaders can support sales teams and motivate them to perform better than ever.
How do you define an average salesperson's performance in your company? What really matters? Outcomes are obvious, but in terms of inputs, what matters?
In general insurance, I'm part of a general insurance company. What we have is a simple metric to say, every day a salesperson has to meet X number of agents, Y number of customers. Okay. That is a simple input parameter. And every person has to acquire a certain number of agents, and therefore how many people has he met in the day is what I measure. and we have all the technology backing it. At the, you know, at the click of my app, he can upload whom he has met, what's the conversation been, what is the status of the in the sales cycle that prospect exists, and so on. So you have the entire technology enablement there, but you measure the salesperson based on what is the input parameter. Once you've established that, you then start looking at the effectiveness parameter. All this, it is not a function only of the effort of the salesperson, but a whole lot of ecosystem around the delivery of the promise. If you are able to fix these two, which is to say the input parameters and continually look at the effectiveness parameters of the salesperson, the outcome is bound to happen.
Aslam, you were sharing about how you are trying to bring ownership mindset by making salespeople actually think of unit level profitability, including themselves as a profitable unit, right? Share more on that.
Yeah, so at my company, what we are basically trying to do is start looking at profitability per salesperson. So it's not enough to just measure on a top line what the guy has delivered, but to start looking at the COGS, that's the cost of goods sold, the gross margins that he's selling, which he can start learning to or can be taught to tweak, which means we have a concept called FSKUs. So SKU, everybody knows. FSKU is the focused SKUs which deliver to the company the higher gross margins. We have a gradation of SKUs. So we have the best, the better, and the good. So we are moving to a system where every Eurochamp will be fixed with a profitability target and will be measured against that.
So in our organization, we have built that culture where we invest in people. So in terms of knowledge of the product, knowledge of processes, some kind of risk management awareness. At various points, we have built some kind of control, some kind of questionnaires, and we also reach out to the customer, check how was the customer experience. So customer engagement for me is very important, and we actually measure that. So if you invest in people, that's where you make the difference. And that's really important in this kind of business where customer is also aware. So that is where we have invested. And as I mentioned at the start also, for us, it's all about people. That's what we've done.
Sunil, question for you. So this is all of sales leaders telling what they're doing right? Now, your org has worked with multiple companies on driving sales transformation. What is it that people are not doing enough of?
Well, I could probably allude to that in two different ways. One is we kind of did a little bit of research globally across 3,000-4,000 sales folks as to what is it that they're doing, what is it working for them, what is it that they're really seeing the difference in the marketplace, or what is it that could probably help them to do well. And kind of when we kind of looked at that results and those reports, we kind of looked at it in two different ways. One is obviously there's a lot of B2B selling which we do globally, and quite a lot of those respondents have been in the B2B space and some in the B2C space. But generally, customers are expecting an experience which they expect from B2C when they're selling in B2B too. So which is very different. The ability for the sales folks to kind of get that kind of environment and excitement going within the whole sales cycle is very different. The second is the entire concept around playbook selling. The ability for people to kind of go back, look at enough data. Obviously, sales being that art part of it, the science has never been missing. And it's always been there. At least in the last few years, it's far more higher than what it was 20 years back or 27 years back when I could probably think of starting my career on. So that's the second part. The third part, clearly technology, artificial intelligence, and all the associated data points which is available today. I think there is far amount of technology which is there for folks to kind of go get them a guided viewpoint of what they need to do better off.
Thank you so much for engaging with us.
So technology is a strategic tool. Earlier, technology was used for productivity, then it was used for data analysis, then it moved into analytics, and today technology, whether it's AI, VR, whichever way you call it, is used to really enhance the customer experience. So a few years ago, we launched what is called as magic mirror in our stores. And when you stand in front of the magic mirror, you don't have to go to the trial room. You can just swipe your hand and keep on working on multiple tops, bottoms, and other products, which will come right on your body without even picking it up. And that saves a lot of time for you. And at the same time, you can actually send out pictures of yourself through social media to your friends get their approval, and then actually shop. So that's magic mirror. So usage of technology for enhancing customer experience is important. Understanding the customer is also very, very important.
The consumer, as we see it, is no more being single channel. He's omni-channel, looking at the price digitally, coming to the shop for an experience, going back digitally to experience the product, to experience the price, the best price, and probably calling our direct sales force for a very detailed demo at home with the whole family is at rest, and still going and buying at on Amazon. So this multi-channel, omni-channel purchase behavior of a consumer is something that digital and automation and AI is going to help marketeers address as a solution for this omni-channel consumer.
So traditionally, insurance has been sort of face-to-face sales where the agent goes and solicits business. But if I have to tell about future, what is going to be there maybe in 10 years or 15 years down the line, I think digital is going to play a very important role. And when we talk about digital, I think the artificial intelligence, the IoT, these things are going to play a very important role where you can actually prejudge the customer, his health status, what exactly is the lifestyle, all of these things which are very important in the life insurance business. Even from claims investigation, all these things, data and IoT is going to be very important.
It's time for a short break. On the other side, we'll bring you more highlights of the fourth edition of the Economic Times Sales Strategy Summit 2018. Krishna Depura, CEO of MindTickle, gave his insights on how to use technology to measure a team's capability and create two-way communication with the consumer.
What are the challenges in sales effectiveness? So primarily what happens? When you're sitting in the boardroom, you're able to understand the challenges, you're able to dynamically define it. But then the problem happens that how do you bridge it to the execution? How do you ensure that the same thing that is in your head gets done in the field, done in a repeated basis? So the whole thing is that, first of all, you need to ensure that whatever my strategy is, whatever my new product launch is, whatever my competitive strategy is, do my people even know it? When you have a scale of 1,000 people and your competition is changing almost every month, what is today's customer thinking? A lot of these things get done at the strategy and headquarters level, but how do you ensure that it gets done at the field? And more importantly, how do you bring the execution discipline? How do you get those insights on a day-to-day basis? What is working, what is not working? How are those people who are running those franchises get to know that there was a deal that was supposed to happen but never happened? So these are a lot of things where technology can come in, and there are frameworks where now you have to move sales capability as not one-off thing, a product launch, a sales kickoff, a party in Goa, taking people to Thailand. No, there's more to it. There will have to be done, but now you'll have to provide as an ongoing process. The framework that we have used with a lot of companies and which has worked very effectively. And it has worked in people where, you know, the team size was close to 25 to 30 people to 20,000 people across the geography. The whole thing is, first three fundamental things that you have to think: are your people aware? Are they knowledgeable enough? Can they articulate it? Do they have the skills? And do you have a discipline where the execution is happening as you mentioned? And most importantly, are you collecting the data, just like you are collecting your efficiency data, just like what you are collecting your marketing data, your pipeline data? Do you have data about the capabilities of your people? The capabilities of your people in real time, identifying those specific gaps at an aggregate level, at an individual level, and all those things feeding into a system. Can you create a system, an engine, where you can ensure that, okay, if I got my strategy right, and if I got my people right, then if I put things into this black box, it will work out. And finally, to make it work, you need to measure it. You cannot measure it, you cannot fix it. So can you quantify what is the capability of your people, which is a very black box kind of thing? Can you somehow quantify into numbers? Can you create dashboards, just like you have created your dashboards for Salesforce and whatever? Can you do that? And if you can bring them, then at least it will bring the visibility into the capability of your team. And once you have that, you will have a better control on the prediction of your revenue, your better control on the pipeline. Thank you very much. Hope you enjoyed the session.
Vikas Agnihotri from Google enlightened the audience on how consumers are rapidly adopting changing technology.
It's kind of really fascinating. And I'm going to try and, you know, put some of the thoughts that were coming in, try and give a bit of a perspective in the way we do stuff at Google. But the one thing that I wanted to actually share with you is that, you know, I have the privilege of actually working with hundreds of companies and interacting with hundreds of CXOs and CEOs, et cetera. And the one thing that stays very dear to me is the fact that, you know, organization cultures actually determine a lot more than what we give credit to in terms of pretty much everything that happens across the organization. And, you know, when we were talking about it, I was told that, you know, one of the topics was same sales strategy, same results, are you innovating? And I remembered Albert Einstein, who actually said or defined insanity actually as trying to do the same thing again and again and expecting different results. So if you really think about that, you just need to innovate, and you've heard everybody else talk about the speed with which technology is changing. Fact of the matter is that the speed with which technology is changing, consumers are actually adopting to it a lot faster than the marketeers are. And therefore, it puts a lot of onus on all of us in terms of how do we stay in touch with the kind of movement that we are seeing that's being brought in by technology. Thank you so much.
World-renowned executive coach John Matton graced the stage and engaged the audience on the topic of intelligent leadership. He also spoke on how to unlock the full potential of your mind to achieve great results in the sales arena.
Inner core drives the outer core. I want you to think about your soul when you leave here today. I want you to ask yourself, is my inner core as strong, mature, and vibrant as it needs to be? Is my value system operating on the right cylinders? For example, you know what will ignite your heart? Courtesy, compassion, altruism. Altruism's a value. Think about this as leaders in the room. If you can ignite courtesy, compassion, and altruism, you've got somebody called an engaged employee. Interesting, isn't it? Think about this whole concept of happiness. How many people that you might know in your life who pursue happiness? There's so many people running around saying, how do I get to be happy? You know what's really interesting? And you already know this. All of you know this. Happiness is not to be pursued. Happiness right in front of you. It's right in front of you. It's in front of all of us. It's a decision that we need to make. Because ultimately, I'm going to be happy if I create courtesy, compassion, altruism. I make you centered and happy. If I make people happy, guess what? I'm happy. Managers who are really, really good, who understand that concept, create engaged people who will literally unleash for that executive. God bless everybody. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So in IoT, there is a whole lot of, there's actually a revolution happening which is helping products become better. Okay. Moving on, when you combine this with artificial intelligence, what essentially you're doing is you're able to scale up your business at a much rapid pace. So in a situation where you needed a lot of manpower, a lot of those decisions, a lot of those algorithms are today being digitized. So when you have IoT, when you have AI, you're making the entire business very, very scalable. You're also taking service levels to a whole new, absolutely different dimension.
We take one step ahead. AI tells that, let's not just look at what has been gone in the past, but we learn from the past and predict the future. And the focus is shifted from descriptive analytics to predictive analytics. The process we use, something called three types of clustering. One is called K-means clustering. It's an AI algorithm. Then it's called as hierarchical clustering. And one of the very popular is called density-based scan clustering. These are the different algorithms that we try to use to understand the profile of the customer, not against a religion, sex, or state, but based on the buying pattern, on the behavior of the customer itself. That's the power of AI, man.
A lot of data is getting generated in petabytes.
Right.
And even for, and when I say petabytes, it's for a particular organization. So it becomes of paramount importance that we need to get something out of the data. Now there are two questions actually which need to be answered. Okay, one first very important question is that, am I collecting the right data? Mm-hmm. Is it relevant or is it garbage? Second very important point is that, what do I make out of that data? The bigger question is that, how to make actionable insights, how to evaluate the data which is getting generated. I think there, you know, someone like, maybe AI can be used, mm-hmm. Or we use AI, that's what I'll we'll say. So in CloudQ, what we try to do is we try to answer some very pertinent business questions which companies have.
We must know and we must decide in the beginning what we are going to analyze. Out of this data, what is important and what is not so important. And this is where the skill and the experience will always come into play. And without this, if you do that, I'm sure, you know, you will always end up into mess. And, you know, I heard someone was saying it is like analysis paralysis. So how we, you know, keep ourselves insulated from such kind of analysis paralysis is that a team must decide, you know, what we are going to chase and what is the bigger purpose behind analyzing this data. If the purpose is clearly defined, I'm sure, you know, we can always fix up the parameters on which we are going to, you know, churn this data, and so that the desirable output which was intended in the first attempt itself is available to the decision makers.
The Economic Times Sales Strategy Summit 2018 finally concluded on a high note, motivating the sales wizards to put in their best efforts as they look to redefine the future of sales.
Partnered by Times Influence.